الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء والجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين، وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. First of all, we ask Allah تبارك وتعالى to relieve the all pain from Muslims around the world, especially in Gaza. May Allah تبارك وتعالى give them patience. May Allah تبارك وتعالى descend سكينة upon them. May Allah تبارك وتعالى أن يفرج همومهم وأن ينفس كروبهم. صلى الله على عبد رسوله سيدنا محمد. So we still in fiqh lessons. Last time we start with كتاب الصلاة. Today we'll continue also. Today we'll talk about the salah, how we perform salah, what's the arkan, if I miss some of this arkan, and all of this stuff, or adhan also we can say. So we'll start with adhan and iqama, because I want to highlight something. As we go through these lessons, we'll highlight these differences, famous differences between a'imma, which when you pray in another mosque, you'll find this. So you thought this is a big mistake. It's just another madhab. So it's very, very important to be aware of this. In this case, when we talk about adhan, we'll find if you go to one masajid from who follow the Hanafi madhab, their iqama is very long. Their iqama, in their iqama, they repeat the adhan and they add قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. Where this come from? Come from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in iqama and adhan, he teach it in different way. Because Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in his life, there are four مؤذنين or five, if the hadith in Abu Dawud is authentic, four famous مؤذنين in the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The first one and the most famous is Bilal. Bilal radiyallahu anhu. Bilal is the muadhin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in entire his life. Subhanallah. The second muadhin, which in Medina, it's Ibn Ummi Maktoum. He was a blind, and he used to make adhan al-fajr, the second adhan of fajr. The third muadhin is Muadhin of Mecca. When Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam conquered Mecca, he chose a young man called Abu Mahdura. Called what? Abu Mahdura. His voice was very, very nice. Used the poet in Mecca, they used to mention in their poetry Abu Mahdura before he became Muadhin. وَالنَّغَمَاتِ مِنْ أَبِي مَحْذُورَ وَمَا تَلَى مُحَمَّدٌ مِنْ سُورَةٍ. So Abu Mahdura, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him adhan. But he taught him adhan slightly different than the adhan you know. The adhan of Abu Mahdura, you can find now when you go to Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco, Mauritania, Senegal, Mali, West Africa. All this country which is Maliki Madhab, they follow the adhan of Abu Mahdura. What's adhan of Mahdura? Same adhan you know, except he say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, repeat it quietly to himself. For example, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, then ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول 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 الله. And the rest is the same. Some scholars say, why Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم changed slightly? Because the people of the Mecca, they convert to Islam very late. Very late. They want them to listen to Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam twice. Maybe. But this has become one adhan and it's becoming famous in West Africa If you go there, so don't say this is they are ignorance. They are not ignorance. This Adhan Abu Mahdura in Sahih Muslim. And also, there's another also from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, another version of Iqama, which is Hanafi Madhab, they took this. Repeat the Adhan and add قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةُ قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةُ. So when you go to any Hanafi Madhab, you will find this Iqama. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. And usually I live in Bolton and the majority of masajid there is Hanafi madhab. And when they sometimes ask me to make iqama, I make iqama on madhab al-ahnaf. Because that's the hikmah. If you are in the mosque, which is majority of them is one madhab, just follow that madhab. That's the hikmah. Because then you not make any distraction for especially elderly people. So that's the adhan and the iqama. Another thing also, adhan in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Fajr adhan was two adhans, which is still in many Muslim countries, but some country they... In the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Adhan al-Fajr is two Adhans. Adhan before the time and Adhan when the time begin. That Adhan before time, to wake up those people who want to fast, to remind them to have some suhoor. And Bilal used to make the first Adhan. And Ibn Ummi Maktoum make the second adhan. And the second adhan, he say, حَيَّعَ الصَّلَاةُ خَيْرٌ مِّنَ النَّوْمِ الصَّلَاةُ خَيْرٌ مِّنَ النَّوْمِ. And some massage in this country, they do it in Ramadan specifically, just to make sure some people, they have suhoor. So another thing also, Prophet ﷺ encouraged us when we hear adhan to repeat after the muezzin, except two statements, حَيَّ عَلَى الصَّلَاةِ حَيَّ عَلَى الْفَلَاحِ. In this statement we should say, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. حَيَّ عَلَى الصَّلَاةِ, it means come to salah. حَيَّ عَلَى الْفَلَاحِ, come to the success. When you hear this, you say, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ. It means, oh Allah, I want to come, but I know that every action I will do in this life is after your permission. Give me permission to pray. Give me permission to go to the mosque. I believe, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. No strength, no any action without your permission. And when the muezzin finish, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم encouraged us to say, أشهد لا إله, to say, اللهم صل على محمد. Before you say, اللهم رب هذه الدعوة. Very famous mistake. Some Muslims straight away, اللهم رب هذه الدعوة. Before اللهم رب هذه الدعوة, it's Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم encouraged us to make الصلاة والسلام على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإذا سمعتم المؤذن فقولوا مثل ما يقول ثم صلوا علي. So say اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل إبراهيم. Then say اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آتي محمدا الوسيلة والفضيلة وابعث مقاما محمودا الذي وعدته. That's according to adhan. And I encourage everyone here to have adhan at your home, because we live in a country we can't hear adhan outside loudly. So it's very, very, very important to buy this device where you can hear adhan at home. Very important for your children. They will grow up and they listen, hear adhan 5 times a day. So they feel that this is Islamic environment. That's according to adhan. Then we go to Kitab al-Salah. Last time we talked about some very important thing. Today we talk about the preconditional thing. Before you pray, there's some conditions before you pray. We mentioned already So we'll mention it again. First of all is niyyah. Before you pray, you should have niyyah. What does niyyah mean? It means if you pray Isha, in your mind, you are praying Isha. It's not verbal things. Don't say, Allahumma inni usalli al-Isha. Oh Allah, I pray Isha now on Friday, 10th of November, 4 rak'at, 2 rak'at. You don't need to do all of this. Just niyyah mahalluha al-qalb. The place of niyyah is here. But we need niyyah. Why niyyah is very important? Because sometimes some people, they just wake up and they pray and they don't know what they pray even. Or they just join salah with that. So niyyah is very, very important. Second is dukhulul waqt. That time is entered. We talked about that last time. Third is satrul awra. You should cover the awra. And when ulama talk about awra, they talk about the minimum level. So maybe you read in some fiqh book, awra of the man is from navel cold, the navel and the knee. So you thought, okay, I will wear just something from the navel and the knee and I will pray. No, the fuqaha usually take about what's the minimum level. If you don't have anything, just this, okay, cover the minimum awra. But for salah, you should wear the best clothes. يَا بَنِي آدَمَ خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. So you should, your best clothes, you should wear because you will meet your Lord. So, سَتْرُ الْعَوْرَى. The fourth thing is, if there is any najasa, impure things, in your clothes or in the place you will pray, you should make sure of that. And then, istiqbalu al-qibla, which is very obvious. We just need this when we are traveling, and we talk about that in another lesson, the ahkam of traveling. So, now you prepare yourself to salah, now we enter salah. So we talk today just about the ahkam inside salah. And we want to start with this hadith, which is very, very important. And it's good to everyone to remind himself about this hadith. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day was teaching his companions in the mosque. And suddenly one man came, and in the end of the mosque he prayed two rak'ah. And then he came and gave salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallam responded, "Wa alayka as-salam wa rahmatullah. Irji' fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Go and pray again. You didn't pray. So he went again and prayed two rak'ahs again and come and make salam. Prophet sallam respond, same statement. Irji' fa salli fa innaka lam tusalli. Go and pray again, you didn't pray. Three times he say, go and pray again. Then in the eventually he said, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ لَا أُحْسِنُ غَيْرَ هَذَا فَعَلِّمْنِي. I didn't know, that's my salah, teach me. And he taught him the salah. This hadith is very famous in every book of fiqh. The fuqaha called this hadith, حَدِيثُ الْمُسِيءِ صَلَاتَهُ. This hadith, the problem with that man, he prayed very fast. Very fast. Which is the major problem. Sometimes you pray very fast, then you can't even, your bones or your joints, they can't relax or come in any status. That type of salah is invalid. And fuqaha try to make a minimum level also, bare minimum thing. So they said, if you are standing and you make ruku', you should stay in a time that you can say Subhana Rabbi al-Azim one time. That's the minimum level. So I'm standing like this, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. You can go. This is valid. Not a good salah, absolutely. But it's valid salah. But if it's less than that, Allahu Akbar, Subhana Rabbil A'la. Allahu Akbar, Subhana Allahu Al-Hamida. That's invalid. Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim, take 2 seconds. It means 2 seconds that you come in that rukun. But less than that, this is invalid. Some youngsters, when they make sujood, they make sujood like when the chicken want to eat something, just, you know, when the chicken eat that Prophet ﷺ told us this example. Don't make this in sujood. Sujood is like this. That's invalid. You should rest in a time you can say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la one time. So this hadith, Prophet ﷺ teach us how to pray. So the first thing, and I will mention the small differences between Muslims, to just reassure all of you that all of these differences are details. So if you find your brother, another brother, he do this, you just follow another madhab, which is interpretation. And this khilafat, many of them is between Sahaba themselves. Or when a imam try to extract the ahkam, they said, is this hadith valid, authentic or not authentic? But all are details. So for example, they all consensus that when you make takbir, takbir is the first thing, you have to stand and then make takbir. The first rukun is standing and the second is make takbir. Here I want to pause and highlight a famous situation always happened to some people who come late to salah. And the situation is this. Imam now is in ruku'. And this person come quickly. And before he stand, Allahu Akbar. He even not stand straight. He just come into the masjid, Allahu Akbar. Go to ruku' straight away. No, don't do it. Say Allahu Akbar when you are standing. Allahu Akbar and then go to ruku'. Allahu Akbar, then go to ruku'. Don't go straight away. Then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you see some Muslims, they put their hands like this on their chest. Some people under the navel, some people just straight. All this again are details. They said some people follow that madhab, some people, because both opinions, they had a hadith, but the discussion is which more authentic. I personally believe that the more authentic is to put it on your chest. However, if I see my brother next to me put under the navel, it's okay. That's the Hanafi and Hanbali, both, not just Hanbali, Hanafi. Even Hanbali madhab, تحت السرة. They have hadith in Ali radiallahu anhu, but the other ulama is not authentic. But what I want to say here is to put here or there, it's not a big issue. The big issue is to hate your brother because he have a different opinion in this issue. That's a big problem. So always we should remind ourselves that we are brothers. To come together, that's more important. And to make khushu' in salah, that's the core point in salah. Khushu'. And then, yes? Leave it down. That's the opinion of Madhab al-Malikiyah. The famous opinion in Maliki is leave it down. They have another narration of this. But yes, if you travel to the Mauritania or Morocco, Algeria, you'll find people like this. So don't think it's not a big issue. If you travel to that countries, all West Africa or North Africa, you'll find Allahu Akbar and they put hand this. Because that's Madhab al-Malikiyah. If you feel that's not strong opinion, it's okay. But to pray, don't enter the masjid, in Morocco look, oh no, are they Muslims? Okay, they are Muslims and Maliki. So pray with them and smile to them. That's very, very important. And after that, Prophet ﷺ say to the person, اقرأ الفاتحة ثم اقرأ ما تيسر معك من القرآن. ثم, I want to highlight here, when you pray sunnah, or even fard behind imam, usually sunnah, usually many people, they have two surahs, only two. They recite these two surahs in every single sunnah, day and night, summer and winter, all their life. قل يا أيها الكافرون قل والله أحد. Or sometimes إنا أعطيناك الكوثر. قل يا الكافرون so long. إنا أعطيناك الكوثر. Don't do it. Quran is barakah. Try to recite different ayat every time. And when you memorize something, the best way to revise your memorization is during salah. That will make it long and give you khushu'. Then ruku'. You'll find also, so I will just focus on this lesson, on that small differences, just to relieve that misconception. Then we can pray together with no any of these problems coming to our hearts. So you'll find some people, when they want to go to ruku', they will do this, Allahu Akbar, and go to ruku'. Some people, they don't raise their hands. That's also another madhab. That's Hanafi and Maliki. So if you pray in masjid, Hanafi madhab, go to masjid al-Nur, and they will not raise their hands. They are not ignorance. They have a big scholars. But they follow a one very valid madhab. If you go to North Africa or West Africa, you'll find the same thing. They will not raise their hands. So just keep that in your mind. What I do here, I raise my hand. But if I see my brother don't do that, I will pray next to him. Then ruku'. The most important thing in ruku' is to make your back straight. So if you this standing and make ruku', make straight. Don't make like this, just a bit of ruku' or too much. Try to make your back straight. Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Ruku'. Usually when the people come to a king in this dunya, they bow a little bit to show their respect. You are now in front of the king of the all kings, Tabaraka wa ta'ala. So that's ruku'. We mention Al-Azim. He's the only Azim. All these kings in this dunya, we can't say to them Azim. That's the real. Now you are in front of the real Azim. Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim. And then when you stand again after ruku', same thing. Some people, they also made this, which is in hadith four times, before you go to ruku' and after ruku'. And when you go to the third rak'ah, that's three places, which is in hadith in this. Do it, but when you say also your brother, don't do that, it means he's follow another madhab. And then when you go to sujood, be careful. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Umirtu an as-sujuda ala sab'ati a'zum. I have commanded to prostrate upon seven bones. The two feet, the two knees, the two hands, that's six. And the seven is these two things. Your forehead and your nose. Forehead and nose, that's the seventh one. So be, and when you watch your children when they are pray at home, usually they have mistake in this. Either they put their forehead, because usually they want to look under their what's going on behind them. so they don't put their nose, or they raise their feet. So just teach them that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because sujood need to every single bone relax. You are in the best situation now. You put the best thing in your body on the ground to show that I'm slave to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, to beg him to give you whatever you want. So try to take your time when you are in sajda. So some main differences also, you see some from your brothers. When you come to the tashahud, some people in tashahud, they make their finger like this, from the beginning till the end, without moving. It's okay. Some people, they start without anything, and when they reach, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad abdu wa rasul, there is, and they remain till the end. Some madahib, they start like this, and when they reach, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammad rasulullah, and they keep it again. Some madahib, they move it like this, from the beginning to the end. Again, do what, if you trust some scholars and they do that, just do it. But just excuse, make excuse for your brothers. They just follow another madhab. These all details. And then when you, last thing, to make salam. Something in salam, maybe you travel to a North Africa or West Africa, you will find something maybe strange for you. If you go to North Africa or West Africa, they just make one salam. Assalamu alaykum. That's it. That's madhab al-Malikiyya. They have one salam. And the old madhab, they believe that the first salam is the rukun, but the second salam is not rukun. So that, just keep in mind, if you find that, it means they follow one madhab also. But we all agree in this arkan, it means one salam. And so during this arkan, if you miss something very, very important, shall we go to sujood as-sahu? Let me open the question, and if there is time, I will come back to this. I think this is better. I will open the question, and then if there is time, I will come. Yes. That's right. Yes, they do. All madahib, arba'a, they do for takbirat al-ihram. I'm Dawood. Sorry, they told me to repeat the question, because those who follow us in YouTube, they can't. He asked about, you said that Hanafi madhab, they don't raise their hand before ruku'. Do they raise their hand in takbiratul ihram? The answer is yes. The four madhab, they raise their hand on takbiratul ihram. Yes. Just someone remind me to repeat every question. Go on. Sorry? Okay. The question here is, you said that Prophet ﷺ encouraged us to repeat after Mu'adhin, after the Adhan. What about the Iqama? Shall we repeat after them? There's no evidence in this, either repeat or not. That's why some ulama said you can repeat like adhan. Some said just keep it. Yeah. Naam.
Sheikh, you know in the Hanafi madhab, it's true that they don't recite
Ma'mun. Yes. That's okay. Why you got it? Too much details. Okay. The question is it true in Hanafi madhab that if you are ma'mum, pray behind imam, you don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha? Yes, that's the mashhur madhab al-Hanaf, that the Ma'moom don't have to recite Fatiha. Imam will carry. But if he pray alone, that's another thing. Yes.
If you come late, you need to wrap your day in half. If you come late, that's all.
Okay.
When do you still do it with the Imam? Or do you do it?
How many rak'ah you miss?
I missed the first one.
The first one. Okay. It's up to you. You can when you because it's just a sunnah. No. So he said, if I want to raise my hand when I go to the third rak'ah, is that right? Yeah, when you stand up and you miss one rak'ah on imam, yes, you can raise your hand when you go to the first rak'ah. Naam. The question is, if someone wants to recite another surahs, but he memorized just a little amount of surahs, can he bring a standard in front of him and put a mushaf in front of him, either electronic mushaf or, and recite? Okay, in fard, don't do it. In fard, just focus on salah. Recite, even if you don't know just two surahs, just recite surah, repeat these surahs. However, if it's nafila, usually sharia in nafila is very flexible. Sharia, very flexible in nafila. I know there is differences between madahib, but in this issue, I will told you that sharia, for example, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray nafila when he was on his camel. Why sharia is very flexible on nafila? Because he wants you to increase your nafila. Do it a lot. So that he khaffafa min al-ahkam. So you can bring standard in front of you and read. But in fard, don't do it. Naam. Okay, we'll come to Kitab al-Jumu'ah. But I will answer it now, but just keep the question during the same topic. Mas'ud said, is it true that if you miss two Jumu'ah, you will be munafiq? That's a big word. Three. Okay. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fi Sahih Muslim said, "Man taraka thalatha jum'atin tahawunan biha tab'a Allahu ala qalbihi." Wa qala aidan fi Sahih sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "La yantahiyanna aqwamun 'an wad'ihim al-jum'at aw la yakhtimanna Allahu ala qulubihim." He said, "Whoever miss three Jum'ahs with no reason." Very important condition. تَهَاوُنًا بِهَا. He don't care. He don't have any reason for missing Jum'ah. Just he don't care about Jum'ah. If this is the case, and three Jum'ahs after this is very dangerous. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he may tend a big punishment like nifaq. But be careful. تَهَاوُنًا بِهَا. He don't care about Jum'ah. However, if someone have a reason, even more than three Jum'ahs, that's another case. Naam. We are not in Hanafi madhabi, not in Hanafi dars today. Okay, go on. قُنُوتُ النَّازِلَ. Okay. The question is it true that in Hanafi madhab they don't recite Qunut al-Nazila? I don't know the Hanafi madhab in this specific issue. I don't know. I have to research or ask some Hanafi scholar. I don't know. Yes. Okay. You mean you should move your,
yes.
Yes, okay. That's very good. Very good point. He said, if you pray a quietly salah, a sirri salah, salatul dhuhr, salatul asr, for example, if you pray these two salahs, you should recite quietly. But what does quietly mean here? Some people, they just keep their mouth, they don't move anything, just like this. Does that mean quietly? No. Quietly is mean to recite, however quietly, but you have to recite. So, but if you don't move anything, it means you don't recite, you don't read anything at all. No. Afwan, خلينا نغير الاسماء بس. Just new faces, yeah.
What's the ruling on wudu ushtasan? And then also, what's the ruling on praying with eyes closed?
With?
Eyes closed.
Okay. About the socks, we talked about that before last time. Don't absent every time, okay? Attend every lesson. And we'll not repeat. So we talked about the socks. We said nowadays we need this issue, especially in this Western country. Because in Western country you are in workplace and there is no place for wudu, specifically for wudu. It's not good to put your leg or your feet or your foot in a place where the people lay. It's not good because this will cause harm for the big picture for Muslims. So sometimes you need masah ala socks, you know, to just not to. What's the hukum here? We said before that for madhahib, they are very strict in this issue, except Hanbali madhab. Hanbali madhab very flexible about masah ala socks. The other madhahib, they said just khuffain, or should be very thick. You can walk without shoes with it. I will summarize that. For me, I support the opinion that if you need to wipe your socks in workplace or at university, if you need it, you can do it. So the hukum here is same khuffain. Before you go to the workplace, before you go to the university in the morning, make sure that you perform wudu and then you wear that socks. And then when dhuhr time come and you are during the workplace, make wudu, and when you come to the feet, just wipe that feet, just masah, if you need it. Yeah. Sorry? A few? واحد بس ينقل الكلام. Again, say again. Okay. You mean make mess? No, he mean, sorry. He mean if you made wudu morning and your wudu is broken. Okay. You have to, now your wudu is broken, huh? Okay. Okay. So you mean, can I make masah on the shoes even?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Where are you from? Originally? Nigeria is Maliki. Why you ask this? If you are Hanbali, I can say yes. Okay. That's the Hanbali madhab, which is you can even your shoes, you can make masah. We have a hadith that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wear the shoes, sandals, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one day he pray with his shoes and the companions pray with their shoes, and he removed the shoes during the salah, so they remove like him. When he end the salah, he said, why you do that? He say, we just imitate you. He said, Jibril came to me and said, there's something impure in your shoes. So some ulama said, from this hadith, yes, you can even make, if this is difficult for you, to remove the shoes. But if not difficult, it's better to remove it. We need this sometimes when we go somewhere and it's difficult to remove your shoes. Yes, in that case, you can go for this. طيب تفضل. With Imam?
Yes, the Imam, but that's the last one for the Imam.
Okay.
And so if it's Shahud, should you carry on to the end or should you stop? Because it's your first Tashahud.
Ah, so you found Imam in Tashahud, the last Tashahud.
Yes.
Shall you join Imam or not?
No, no. So what you read in your Tashahud, where you should stop.
Ah, okay. Okay, but in Shafi'i Madhab, do you know the middle Tashahud, what it is? Do you study Shafi'i properly? That's not the Shafi'i Madhab. No, Shafi'i Madhab is in the end, in the both Tashahud.
No. So in terms of when you stand up.
I know, but Shafi'i Madhab يقرؤون التشهد والصلاة الإبراهيمية في كلي التشهدين. نعم. خلافا للجمهور. نعم. Okay. If any question regard to if the ma'moom join the imam, just leave it today. Because we'll take just session about imamah and the ahkam of imamah. Just ask me about salah itself.
Okay, yeah, sure.
Naam. I will come to you.
Yeah,
that's fine. Okay.
Now it is our habit.
Okay, that's fine.
Wear the socks on the morning,
Okay, that's fine. That's fine.
Even if we retain
yes, I said that's the Hanbali method. That's okay. Kun Hanbaliyan. Tafadal. Yes. In the end, yes. Alayhi salam wa barakatuh. مسبوق is leave it to another session. That's أحكام الإمامة. Okay, but what about the تكبيرة الإحرام? Okay, all connected. Okay. 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 About loudly or not? Okay. 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 Let me ask this first part. If someone come to join Musallin and he make takbiratul ihram, he said some madhahib said it's rukun to say it loudly. I don't know any madhab of madhahib arba'a, they say it's loudly rukun. I don't know any madhab say loudly is rukun. Loudly. Loudly is not rukun. Say Allahu Akbar. Then you can hear yourself. But you are now in ma'moom. Don't say Allahu Akbar. Then they thought the imam is the one who. That's happened in some countries. In my country, Mauritania, if you pray there, this is very famous. We are praying and someone come, Allahu Akbar. Like an imam. That's not good. Just you can hear yourself. That's the thing, yeah. What's the second part?
Second part,
Okay. Okay. Yes, that's, I told you, this is Imama. Yeah. I will take in details. سأقول لك هذا بالتفصيل. Because you will find your brothers different opinions. Yes. I know that the opinions of madhahib in this issue. هل يبني على الأقوال أو يبني على الأفعال أو يبني الحركات على الأقوال يبني على الأفعال. ثلاث مذاهب مشهورة. طيب. لكن خلينا بس في الموضوع في الصلاة هناك. طيب sorry oh I apologize. What's sorry in Somali? Someone say it. Gone? Huh? Nile Hawa. Rally Awa. Rally How. Rally Aho. Rally Aho. تفضل. No problem, because you come up from your home and your niyyah is this. That's okay. That's okay. Yes.
Second one, if you come the last three, maybe four rak'ah, come last one, and you join the viewers before they say salam alaikum, you have all ajar together.
Okay. If you come to... You catch the salam or not?
You come to salam last before they say salam.
Before they say salam, okay. Someone come to the mosque and they are in the last rak'ah and he joined them. When he joined them, immediately Imam say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah assalam. Did he get the reward? Okay, that's a very good question. If this is a habit, this is a big problem. Some people have this habit. They always catch the salam. That's a big problem. But if it's happened one time, Allah is the most merciful. Okay. Allah musta'an. In Madhab al-Maliki, if you join the masjid and you know this is the last tashahud, don't join them. Because you will not catch anything. Anyway, okay. طيب تفضل. نعم. تشهد. لا ود لي. Yes, I know. I know. Yes. نعم. أعرف أن الشافعية عندهم هذا. إذا فعلها sorry. If you do it because you follow them, as we said before, if you trust one scholar, you just take his fatwa and that's it. That's right.
So
I know Chef. In that case, we'll come back to our lesson last time. What's your status in knowledge? You are not a seeker of knowledge. Ask one scholar you trust in piety and knowledge, and take his fatwa. That's it. No, total. Isa, I will come to you. Just the eldest first. Okay. Salatul Witr. We'll come to that in a separate. Are you every time with us?
I'm new here.
New here. You will come next week?
Yeah.
Okay. Just be patient. We'll talk about the old Sunan. Just I want to focus on Salah. Salah itself. Naam. Adam. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Yes. Good question.
Can
Very good question, Adam. If you are in sujood behind the Imam and you say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la three times, and Imam is still sajid for a while, what should I say? Yes, you can keep saying Subhana Rabbi al-A'la even 100 times. Or you can learn some ad'iya. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has many ad'iya, specific ad'iya during sujood. اللهم لك سجدت وبك آمنت وعليك توكلت سيد وجهي الذي خلقه فصوره وشق سمعه وبصره تبارك الله وحسن سبح قدوس رب الملائكة والروح سبحان ذي الملكوت والجبروت والكذب. There is many أدعية you can learn. If you don't know, just keeping سبحان ربي even 100 times. I hope I'm not that imam who make a long for you, Adam. Okay. نعم نعم حتى تجتهد نعم نعم okay yes you can دعاء yes either you repeat سبحان ربي الأعلى or دعاء دعاء is better. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said this is the time of دعاء. okay after تحيات you can that's another place of دعاء. yes I'll come to you. نعم. Very good question. Can you make dua in English during sujood? Good. That's a famous mas'ala khilafiyya. Summary for me is this. In fard, try not to do it. However, in nafila, yes, you can do it. Nafila, according to sharia, very flexible. You can do in nafila. But when you are in fard, just stick with the Arabic. نعم سوري عيسى تفضل. What قنوت النازلة. Very good. What does عيسى said. عيسى you are 10 years old. Basically 11. 10 or 11. When you will become 11. Less than a week. Oh ما شاء الله. Okay, Isa said, what does قنوت النازلة mean? قنوت النازلة is when something happened like what happened in Gaza now. We can in every single salah, in the last rak'ah, after the last ruku', the imam make dua for those Muslims who are suffering. That called قنوت النازلة. In fard and in congregation. It's no problem also if sunnah, but Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he sent 70 people. All of them are huffadul Quran and very knowledgeable companions. They send them to a tribe, three tribes of Arab. Those Arab people, they ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to send to them some knowledgeable people to teach them Quran. So he picked 70 of very good companions and they went to those tribes and they betrayed them. They killed all of them. Prophet ﷺ was very, very angry. So he spent 1 month every single salah, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, every single salah, in the last rak'ah he made Qunutun Nazila. Okay. New faces, yes, Hamidullah. Oh. Combine what? Subhana Rabbi al Azim and Arkan. Okay, okay. Okay, okay, yes, very good, very good. Okay. Okay, the first question is when you are in ruku' and you do Subhana Rabbi al-Azim three times. If you have time, can you repeat it again? Yes, you can repeat even 100 times. Can you add dua? If you add dua, it's okay, but it's better the dua, it's jins of tasbih. Prophet ﷺ said in Bukhari and Muslim, أَمَّا الرُّكُوعُ فَعَظِّمُوا فِيهِ الرَّبِّ وَأَمَّا السُّجُودُ فَادْعُوا فَقَمِنٌ أَنْ يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. Ruku is for glorify your Lord. That's why we have in ruku, subhana rabbi ala, we have subbuhun quddus, rabbul malaikati wal ruh. That's not dua, that's glorify also. We have subhana dhil malakuti wal jabaruti wal kibriyai wal azama. We have Allahumma laka raka'atu wa bika amantu wa alayka tawakkaltu khasha'a laka mukhi wa azmi wa sam'i wa basari wa mastaqalla bihi qadami. That's not dua. They're all glorifying. Yes, absolutely. You need this when you do qiyamul layl. Qiyamul layl, it's good to make long sujood, long ruku'. Naam, tafadhal. Ah, we come to the Sunan after that. Ah, just new, please, new people, then we can end the session. Yeah. Yes, what I said now is all in authentic. Ah. You mean Witr? We come to Witr, inshallah. That's Sunan. Okay. No. New faces. Yes. You are in? Very good question. You are during the salah and your child is not far from you and you feel that he will face a danger thing. The answer is you have to break your salah. It's not permissible, you have to. Because keeping life is more important now in this situation. So if you afraid he will face a major danger, break your salah immediately. Immediately, yes. That's wajib. Compulsory for you. Yes. Huh? No, you have to start again your salah. Yeah. I ask this question now. Huh? Okay, I said, in Salatul Fard, try to speak just in Arabic. But in Salatul Sunnah, the strongest opinion for me is yes, you can say Urdu, English, any language. Naam. Very good question. If I realize after Salah that my clothes has najasa, we said that 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago. If you realized after Salah, nothing to do. Your Salah is valid. You just wash it for the next Salah. However, when you realize it during Salah, then you have to make something. Either if it's a coat, you can remove it. If it's not, cut the salah and go and clean it. But after salah, no problem. Naam. Okay, if you remember during the salah, you are doubt about your wudu. Wait a minute. If you doubt, if this is a habit, that's another rule. Some people, they have a habit, they always have a doubt of their wudu. That's called in fiqh, waswasa, sahibu salas. The one who always has problem with this. If this is the case, he should ignore this and complete his salah. However, if it's happened one time, and you doubt your wudu, then you have to think first. What's the last time I make wudu? For example, I am now in Salatul Asr. And I'm during the salah. The nafs come to me. Do I have wudu or not? I should wait to think. What's the last time I did wudu? Okay? The last time I did wudu just 20 minutes ago. I'm pretty sure 100% I did wudu. 100% I remember I did wudu. However, did my wudu break? I am doubt. Now go to the certainty. The certainty here is wudu. You understand? No? Sometimes become opposite. Sometimes you are certain that your wudu is broken. But you are doubt if you perform wudu after that or not. Go to the certainty. Break the salah immediately. The second question is about breaking salah. Okay, if you are during salah and you remember 100% you don't have wudu, straight away break the salah. However, sometimes you are in a huge mosque. You have to be wise. If you have cross, there is no problem for people to do it, that's fine. If it's a problem, just sit down. Sometimes a huge mosque. If some mosque like Al-Furqan, it's okay. So, but immediately, this happened to me today in Salatul Maghrib. I come to the mihrab, I want to lead the salah. I remember I don't have wudu. I don't feel shy at all. I told Sheikh Salim, go. Don't feel shy in this situation. Never. Oh, what people will say about me. Let them talk. You'll get reward. But don't feel shy. Never. Wudu is something. No, you don't need salah. Just go. You don't need salam. Okay, the last two questions. Because we need to make just 1 hour fix. Yes, Nigeria. That's my neighbor. West Africa. Go on. He was? Safar. What come close to you?
Dog.
Okay. Did he touch you by his tongue or just come close to you? Okay. Okay. That's a good question. Okay, the strongest opinion, which I support, that dog, if you touch the dog from any place, there's no problem, unless the dog touched by his tongue. The rest of his body, there's no problem. The problem in his tongue, and this is very rare, very rare that the dog will go and ايش يلحس بالانجليزي lick and lick you. That's very rare. So if just touch your body, it's okay. And you are maliki. Do you know what's the madhab al-maliki in kalb? Al-kalb tahirun indana. Okay, the last, yes, you two, the last two questions, go on. One of you, yeah. That's another issue. Go on. you talk about what? Dog? Then? Danger, okay. Okay. Yeah. Who? Okay. You are the imam or what? Okay. Hold you. Just fight a bit. If you want to save a life of anyone, and there is no one can do this job instead of you, you have to break your salah and save a life of human being. Even that man is a non-Muslim. Any human being life, you should. And there is no one can do this job instead of you. You have to break your salah. No doubt. Okay, another question after this, because we have to fix this. Okay, just 1 hour. I'm sorry. Allahu a'lam wa sallallahu ala abdi wa rasuli sayyidina Muhammad. Guys, just one notice. I have another lesson, another private lesson for 1 hour. So just I apologize for any questions after the Q&A session. Yeah.